I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.
Glad you're recording.
Damn it, Josh! What's in that mug? No, look that mug up. What's in that mug?
Wine.
Wow, you really did that?
Jake told me not to. I had to.
Wait, hold on. Aren't you in a hotel right now?
Yeah.
Did you go out of your way to get tea bags just to make that joke to us on the video?
They've got them downstairs.
Okay. But wait, hold on. No, that still doesn't answer my question. You went out of your way.
Yes, I went downstairs for the third time this evening to a little coffee station and got tea bags. So wine tastes terrible with tea in it.
In all fairness, wine tastes terrible without tea in it.
We're going to have to agree to disagree on that one.
I feel like, okay, well, I've had one
like experience. Singing?
No, I've had one experience with wine, and it was just shitty cooking wine. And like,
yeah, don't drink that.
Well, also on top of that, I just wanted it to be grape juice.
Oh yeah. There's the whole thing about your brain telling your taste buds of what to expect just makes shit taste awful.
Yeah, especially awful wine, especially when you want grape juice.
Yeah, so I think that's why I don't like sour beers, because sour beers are pretty fruity and cidery tasting.
Yeah, I'm not a fan.
But my mind says I'm drinking a beer, so I expect to taste a goddamn beer. And then when I get a mouthful of sour Skittles, it's fucking weird.
But how do you feel about Sour Patch Kids?
Well, but I'm expecting that.
Yeah.
But what about Bean Boozled Beans?
Oh, God.
I like the cut grass one.
I think what I hate most about Bean Boozled Beans is how accurate they are. Like, who's the poor sob that had to test these?
Yeah.
Remember the vomit one? I think they got rid of the vomit one.
Oh, God. Why would somebody even make that?
Oh, when I get back to work, I'm going to put a candy jar on my desk and fill it with the Bean Boozled Beans.
Oh, that's so mean.
Oh, or get the Russian Roulette chocolates.
Mm-hmm.
They're chocolates, but one of them has ghost pepper juice in it.
Oh.
Just one of them.
And one in the whole bag?
Well, it's like a tray. It's like a box of chocolates.
Oh man, I would eat all of them just to find the ghost pepper one, though. I mean, I'm not a smart man.
I knew once I said box of chocolates, someone was gonna go there. Ooh, wait, hold on. Have you guys seen the fifth edition Bean Boozled flavors?
No, what we
those new ones?
We've got yeah. So the fifth edition came out, I guess, 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Okay. But maybe this is old news. I guess I just don't keep up with my Bean Boozled. Let me just read through these real quick. There's Dirty Dishwater.
Okay.
Yeah.
Stink Bug. Barf.
Do you think the Stink Bug one probably tastes like the Skunk one did?
Probably.
Maybe.
Okay.
And this one says toothpaste. Isn't that just mint?
Yeah.
Basically, yeah.
But then there's Rotten Egg. Ooh, Stinky Socks. Ooh.
Oh, yes.
Canned Dog Food.
Gross. Oh, that one's disgusting.
So it tastes like canned chili.
Canned chili is not that bad.
Well, they smell the same, though.
No, they don't.
Oh, yes, they do.
Anyway, no, not at all.
What else we got?
Spoiled milk, dead fish, and booger. Ooh. A perennial favorite. This isn't how I was expecting this episode to start out at all. Hey, speaking of starting out this episode, can I just address the elephant in the room real fast?
There better be a goddamn real elephant in somebody's room.
Pamphy, just sit over there.
I have dumb... never mind.
I did get a haircut on Josh's orders last week, but I got it very safely. So, I don't want anybody to worry.
Wait,
I still haven't
got a haircut.
Well, see, the one house that I've decided to put on my visitation list for this whole situation
is the one your children live in.
Yes, and it also happens to house a hairdresser. So,
Well, that's good. Glad you got a haircut.
Yes, thank you. Jordan looks judgy. What?
Did you get your ex-wife to cut your hair?
Yes. It was driving me...
No, it's fine. I just wanted you to say it out loud on the podcast.
Oh, yeah. Well, I was just going to rub it in also that, you know, when you get along with your ex, you can get great things like haircuts.
Yeah, I'm fucking super jealous you get along with your ex.
Yeah, it's nice. I got a haircut in the middle of a pandemic. I also fixed one of her sprinklers. It was a fair trade.
I don't know. Wait, what was wrong with the sprinklers? Might not be a fair trade.
Clog nozzle, man.
I've had a clogged nozzle before.
So, but I just wanted to make sure that everyone knows that I did not seek out a hair salon and do unsafe things. And I also just wanted to bulldoze over Josh's clogged nozzle comment, mostly.
So you bring it back up? Dumbass.
Shut up, Josh.
So I got something to say. I want to pimp a product, but I'm not going to say their name because we're not getting paid for it.
Wait, before you pimp it, can you just sit on your hands just for a second?
Yes.
Because I want to say what we're going to do this episode. Guys, if we just become like a top four show, I would not complain.
That'd be funny.
That being said, we're going to do another top four list this week. I'm telling you up front, so if anyone wants to skip all the ranty banter that I'm sure will happen, but I'm going to advise against. We're going to do top four documentaries this week. That being said, if there's a recommended list that you want to make up, listener and or YouTube viewer, let us know what top four topic you'd want us to cover. Either on Twitter or down here in the YouTube comments. I don't know who actually watches this, but that's why I wanted to say that at the top of the show. We're taking
Requests. I have something that I want to talk about for a second. I would like to publicly thank Jillian for going through the proper channels to issue a complaint through Twitter.
Yeah, that was hilarious.
You know what that means? Robbie is our official complaints department now.
Robbie's the new HR.
Good luck, Robbo. So if you'd like to lodge a complaint, do it on Twitter at, what is it?
At RLHess6666.
There you go. And if you want to make a request, at Mickey Mutineers. Or any of us besides Robbie, unless you're complaining.
Yeah. Robbie's for complaints.
Now, Josh, what were you going to pimp?
So, Vanessa bought me this super concentrated deodorant. No. Hear me out.
Hold on. You're going to get nipple cancer.
No. It's not super concentrated. It's just a better fucking deodorant.
Look, I'm super concentrated.
It really works good. It's expensive as fuck, though. It's $10 for a fucking stick of this.
Jeez.
But here's the thing. It lasts me 4 fucking months. So it saved me money. So, yeah. I'm not saying the name of it. I'll tell you guys after if you really give a fuck. But I never had a stick of deodorant last more than a month, so I'm happy. Turn my camera around. You guys are fucking weird.
No, I'm super concentrated. So is Jordan. No, I want to know the name of it.
I'll tell you after the show.
Just tell me now. What if the listener wants to know?
It's Duke Cannon.
Oh, what the hell did you say the name on the show?
They sell that money.
No. They're going to become a sponsor now. They just don't know it yet.
I can't spell that. I'm looking it up right now.
Yeah, anyways, they got a lot of good projects.
I like that I got to Duke C, and the first thing was Duke Kaboom. That's even better.
Oh, so there's an Ask Reddit thread today about what fictional character do you really hate?
And yeah, there was.
Everybody hates Kailu.
Caillou,
whatever.
Isn't he like super whiny or some shit?
Yeah.
I don't know. Never seen it. But they hate him.
He's the worst. He's worse than Scrappy. Also, on that list, I didn't know who most of those characters were. I felt weird. I knew Scrappy.
You know what? Two things. One, I don't think Scrappy is anywhere near as bad as people think he is. And two, we should make that list a show. Like, we should talk about that list on the show.
Make it a top four.
Top four most hated fictional characters?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
I love this. Okay, I'm writing it down.
Okay, but Nurse Ratched made it. She's a bitch.
I don't know who that is.
You've never seen One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest?
Nope. Just the end.
Oh, man. With the freaking Indian escaping and running off?
Yeah, with the drinking... Wait, no. I saw the Simpsons version of that. Never mind.
Yeah, threw the freaking drinking fountain through the window and ran off?
Yeah.
Did I? Man. Native American. I'm sorry.
You know what? You tried, and you corrected yourself. I'm giving it a pass. This is fine. This is totally fine.
Okay. Hey, that's a learning. That's a learning.
Right. This is going to sound weird, but I'm actually proud of Josh for admitting that right now.
Aw, thanks, guys. Oh, hey, this town I'm in is where Pepsi was invented.
Really?
Yeah. That is Combino, Jordan.
So, in the town you're in is where they tried to bring down Coke.
Thank you, Robbie. Thank you for noticing.
I'm still waiting on my new figure that I've recently got.
Wait, hold on. Put a pin in this. Let's let Josh and Jake finish their sentence, and then we'll have our conversation.
So, Pepsi, New Bern, North Carolina.
Jordan, is that a transformer on your desk, or are you just happy to see us?
Yes.
Oh, no. Hey, the one that says rescue, is it a helicopter?
No, this one's a helicopter, though.
No. But
so, funny story. I mean, the one that says rescue is an ambulance.
Oh.
Funny story about this. I bought this on eBay, and I was... All right, listen, I'm just going to fully come out and admit something, guys. Since I've been in quarantine, I haven't really been... able to go out, do things.
Well, that's quarantine.
And the entire COVID-19 thing is just causing me a lot of fucking anxiety and don't really get to go out and do things that bring me happiness. So I've been doing a lot of retail therapy, probably more than I need to.
Oh, I do that when I'm in my trailer in Northern California.
Yeah, so you understand where I'm coming from.
Yep, I buy stupid shit.
Yeah.
A lot of it.
Yeah. So Tuesday morning, my stimulus check hit my bank account. And also, like, I had a good bit of money in my bank account because I wasn't going anywhere. I wasn't paying for gas. I think I put gas in my car once, maybe twice, since this whole situation started back in the middle of March. So, like... The $300 or $400 I would have spent on socializing gas didn't get spent.
What was that clicking sound?
What is that clicking sound?
It's Robbie.
I have no idea.
Oh, it's Josh this time. Stop it. Anyway, sorry, Jordan.
Yeah, so you know what? I decided treat yourself. The problem is I didn't stop treating myself. So... I bought three different Transformer combiner sets. Three. And then I ordered some other stuff. Like, I've got some Star Wars figures that I picked up today. And Josh picked up a Star Wars figure for me the other day. So this figure that I picked up the other day, I bought on eBay, and I got a little overzealous. I got a little trigger happy. So I won this whole thing. And you can only see it if you're watching the YouTube video. But this guy, who's the helicopter,
that Josh didn't recognize.
Yeah. Doesn't belong with this set. I didn't realize it at the time. But so here's the deal. Like, the character is actually supposed to be a helicopter. He's actually a repaint of this figure, but he's red and white. And this one is white, blue, and orange. So it's the same figure that would be included in this set. It's just painted differently. So I'm not too angry, but I didn't realize that I bought it with the wrong one until like an hour ago. So now I'm kind of looking on the internet because it's going to bug the shit out of me. I need to buy the actual, like, accurate character.
So you really haven't stopped treating yourself?
No, I haven't. And there's a couple more that are going to be shipped to me. Those were some of the ones that I pre-ordered that I've been doing those unboxing videos on YouTube for.
Yeah.
So I have those coming to me. And I think after those come to me, I'm pretty much done.
I like the pretty much.
Well, yeah, I mean, the only way I would probably go out of my way to buy something is if I found something I really wanted at a good price. But I, with all the stuff that I pre-ordered earlier this year, like, I ordered that giant Scorponok figure that's supposed to come out in August.
Mm-hmm.
And I ordered like 4 or 5 of the figures that are supposed to come out the same day. So like that's like a $220 day that my credit card is going to be.
Jeez.
Hit wow. For that day. So I do need to slow down. But I was thinking about buying the Predacons, Josh.
Yeah.
The make the Predaking. Because he's as big as the Devastator that I have. And really? I can't decide if I want to... Not the Devastator that you got me, but the big Devastator that I have.
I saw the big one when I went over to your house.
So it's that big, and I can't decide if I want to get it, but it's $150. So I'm kind of taking this gamble of, do I want to spend $150 on it now? Or see if it'll show up at like a Ross or a closeout store for $60 or $70.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, Jordan.
Yo.
Robbie might have gotten a real job.
Oh, yeah?
At the Amazon warehouse.
Yeah, okay. I have.
So if you ever have a late Amazon package, from now on, you can just blame Robbie. Okay.
And of all the people that could possibly have it, it's happened to Jordan like 3 times in the last month.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also here, my mom ordered some stools, and the one that I chose, which was a dark blue,
got lost,
and then it got returned. So she had to get.
But luckily she got refunded and
got a new stool. It sucked. And yeah, also Amazon.
Those stools were overstocked early.
Oh, Josh, do you remember that Soundwave reissue that you picked up?
Yeah.
Yeah, they've been hitting the clearance aisles for $13.
God damn it. I paid $50 for yours and $50 for mine.
That's $100. Whoa, wait. Why do you have a combat knife?
Combat knife? This is a...
Wait, specify yours. Like, were you talking to me or Robbie?
No, I picked up Soundwave for you, right?
No, you picked that one up for Seamus. I already had it whenever you picked it up.
Oh, no, I got you the Optimus Prime. That's the one I shipped to you.
No, you picked up the Devastator for me.
Yeah, I have the G1 Optimus.
Okay, so I got two Devastators then. That's what it was.
This is Transformers talk with the Mickey Mutineers.
And mentioning Transformers, I'm also getting a new figure.
What'd you get?
Ectotron.
Oh, nice. I've got one.
Wait, is that a pretty Ghostbusters good crossover?
It's the yeah. Ecto-1, yeah, but as a Transformer.
Fun, I'll grab it.
Yeah, I want to see it. Also, can I just point out how adorable I think the toy exchange is here between all of us? I also want to point out
that I have none of them. Like, I'm just buying shit for everyone else.
I'd say you haven't bought me anything, but no, I have a Godzilla action figure that you bought me.
Yeah, at Epcot.
Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, still in the box. Nice. And I have a
mug. I opened it up, but...
Is it Grimlock?
The picture, it does kind of look...
Yeah, the picture looks like Grimlock almost. Maybe not.
Well, what I think is pretty cool is if you look... Let me see if I can find the... Yeah, like right up on the logo. Mm-hmm. It's kind of hard to see, but there's a whole bunch of like ectoplasm splattered all over the Transformers logo.
Oh, nice. Yeah,
that's cool.
So, but no, like I opened it up and I like the only reason they keep him in the box is one, like he doesn't really, like it looks cool in the box, but like he just looks, stands out like a sore thumb with the rest of the Autobots.
Yeah. With how I'm displaying mine, it won't really affect it. That's awesome, though.
Like, it's awesome just like that. And then it just happens to be a Transformer also.
Yeah, like, I have the Lego Ecto-1.
Don't move. Oh, Robbie's going to make noise. Damn it, Robbie.
As you can see here, Lego.
Nice.
And I'm pretty sure it's like this size, the Transformer.
Have you guys seen the Lego Stormtrooper helmets?
No.
Dude, they're awesome. And they come with a little display stand. You know, like when you have your freaking your helmet, you can get the display stand for it.
Yeah.
And the Lego Stormtrooper helmets have a display stand like that and everything. They're pretty fucking cool.
That's awesome.
Anyways, this knife, I found it at work. Decided it was mine. It's a spring blade knife. I'm going to cut myself with it.
Not an edit point.
Not on purpose.
That was not an edit point. I just want to make that clear.
Yeah, no, I'm fiddling.
Hey, here's an odd question. How do I sound?
Not as clear as usual, but not as bad as Josh.
Okay, because
really?
I'm
not bad today?
No, you sound fine.
Are you sure that I'm not on par with Josh?
You know, I'll leave that up for a listener. Hey! If you want to tell us who sounds better between Jordan and Josh this week, send your request to, send it to Jordan Gastly. Let him know.
That's Jordan Gastly at RLHess6666.
.com.
No, I got Chelsea a pair of AirPods for her birthday last week, and I'm kind of testing them out because I don't know if I want a pair for me.
Oh, so I love mine.
I paired them to my laptop, so that's what I've been. That's what I'm doing.
That's the microphone is coming through.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I absolutely love my AirPods.
Is that what you're using?
Yeah. See.
Oh,
do you use both of them or just one of them?
For the podcast and music, I use both. But if I'm just calling someone, I just put one in.
Oh, should I use both?
Oh, that's up to you. It's just for me. It just kind of blocks out everything else. That's all.
Wait, does each one have a microphone?
Sense. Yes, but it only uses one microphone.
Okay, so it wouldn't matter if I put both of them in anyway.
No, it won't.
All right.
You could get some sweet stereo from our angelic voices going on. Even though this is recorded in mono. I think.
I thought I had mono once. Turns out I was just really bored.
I saw that coming. I love that quote.
I love that movie.
That's a great movie. That could have been on the list, because this is not a good movie. But Wayne's World is top-notch.
Yeah. Yeah, the second one is good.
It's good. It's still the second best Saturday Night Live movie.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, did you guys watch that Brad Pitt freaking Saturday Night Live intro?
Actually, no. I thumbs up it and with intention to go back and watch it, but I have yet to go back and watch it.
Yeah, I haven't watched it either.
He pretty much nailed Dr. Fauci. it's pretty funny. Yeah. So, you know, real quick before we get rolling, how's everybody doing?
Just really no change. Still tired, still numb, still hating a lot of things going on, but I've been trying to actively distance myself from interacting, like, online with things and reading things, because that was really taking a toll on me in the last two weeks.
Oh, dude, it's giving me anxiety.
Right. Yeah, that's
what I mean. Like the whole, now the whole fucking ass clown press conferences are just, the fucking man child is giving me anxiety.
Yeah, that's why I had to distance off. There was a highlight this week, unrelated to this, that made me feel good, though.
What's that?
Sorry, if you want to keep going. Well, I became a member of a book club.
Oh, so did I.
That's cool. Wait. What? You guys didn't invite me to your goddamn book club?
I didn't even invite me to the book club.
Technically, neither did I. However, you have to be able to read.
I can fucking read.
Come on.
All right. Yeah, they didn't teach us in the Coast Guard. It wasn't necessary.
Yeah, the book isn't written in signal flags, Josh.
I can read those, motherfucker.
I know. You read them to me once and it freaked me out. The book was written in signal flags. It'd be weird. Anyway, well, George.
You know what? I know what I'm doing this summer now. Well, I'm sitting on my fucking mountainside. I'm not getting days off because of this whole coronavirus thing. So while I'm sitting on my goddamn mountainside, I'm going to write a fucking book in signal flag.
How about instead you read a book with us all together? Jordan, go ahead.
Okay. Oh, I can't wait for this movie.
Yeah,
Sand Dunes.
I haven't read that book.
I'm just afraid they ripped too much off from Star Wars.
You get the hell out! You get out!
I haven't read that book. I need to, though.
Okay,
it's good, Rob.
So for the audio listener, the book club we're in is a Dune book club because the major motion picture is coming out in November. That is a legitimate fear I have, Josh, is that people not in the know are going to think that it did indeed rip off Star Wars. Especially because it has a Star Wars actor in it.
It ripped off Star Wars so hard they stole Poe Dameron.
So I know why Jason Momoa shaved now.
What?
I know why Jason Momoa shaved now.
Because he's Duncan Idaho?
Right?
Yeah.
What a silly name, though.
I mean, it's no worse than Han Solo, who is the same character.
Yeah. Except Duncan Idaho's got a drinking problem.
I mean, we don't know that Han Solo didn't have a spice problem.
All right, good call.
Yeah, no, but Heather, our friend Heather Dobson, author of Memoirs of a Future Ghost, that's her favorite book. Hey, there you go. If you're watching the YouTube page, Jake's holding up a copy. Wait, did you just have that, like, right there?
It doesn't leave my side, Jordan.
Oh, okay.
You know what? Her favorite book. I gotta get the hard copy of it.
Oh, Dune?
It's good.
Heather's book.
So, she sent me a PDF of the new book, and I started reading the new book. And because I'm writing the foreword for it. So I started writing the foreword yesterday, and I'm going to work on it again tomorrow and the next day. So I'm giving myself about an hour each day to write. So that way, by the end of the week, I can whittle it down and I can just send it off to her. So, but no, so her favorite book is Dune. And since it's going to be made into a film, or it has been made into a film, we're just waiting for it to come out.
Yeah.
She had this idea on Facebook to have a book club where we read and discuss Dune. And I was added to it, much to my surprise, because I wasn't expecting to be added to a book club. And I was very pleasantly surprised, because Dune has always been on my radar to read. But I just never was like, hey, you know what? I'm going to go buy a copy of Dune. This kind of made me go buy a copy of Dune. Also, Jake, nobody told me that this book was almost 1,000 pages
long. Jeez.
Yeah.
Well, so I didn't read it. I got the audiobook over last summer while I was driving.
One of the best audiobooks I've ever heard.
It's fucking amazing. But it's like 20 hours.
It's the book itself before the appendices is 794 pages.
I just want to go get mine too.
So hey,
you guys have the same book.
No, his has a sticker that says "Soon a major motion picture." I don't have.
Yeah,
the sticker.
I wish mine. I wish I didn't have. No, it's printed on the book. It's not a sticker. I wish mine didn't have that. But also, since I can't go into a bookstore, I had to order it online and do curbside pickup. And of course, they picked the one copy that has like creases in the spine.
Oh no!
Oh no!
And like, there's a giant gash in the back, and I'm like, damn it!
The only book, the biggest book I have is this one.
But that's all five fucking Hitchhiker's Guides.
Yeah,
that's
five books, man.
Yeah. But it's like, anyway, the biggest one I have.
This isn't the thickest book I have, but this is one of them. Anyway.
Oh, well, if we're comparing books. Never mind. It was funny.
I don't want to know how thick your book is. But Josh, I just invited you to the book club.
It's weird that it's a pop-up.
Oh, nice.
What?
Sandworm just eats your face?
No, I'm fine. I guess retail therapy aside, I've had to actually work at my retail gig. And it's causing me severe anxiety.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I don't blame you.
So,
are you wearing your PPE?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I wanted to shout out to my friend Josh and his wife Courtney. Courtney's been making masks, and she said if you grab some fabric, I'm more than happy to make a couple masks for you. So I went to the Walmart around the corner from me, and they had some Transformers Generation 1 fabric.
Nice.
So I grabbed some, and she made two masks for me. And one of them has Optimus and Megatron on one, and the other one has Bumblebee and Starscream.
That's so cool.
Nice.
That's
yeah.
Badass. Like, I saw your mask, but I didn't know that that's where it came from.
Yeah, so my friend Courtney made it for me, so.
And you got your nitrile gloves still, right?
Yep, I still have a bunch left. I haven't really been using the gloves as much. Well, I'm using them sparingly, essentially.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I don't.
That makes sense.
So I don't mind touching, like money tender. Like, I don't mind touching cash, and I don't mind touching somebody's credit card. But I always sanitize my hands after, though, just in case.
Yeah.
But good news for us is that we got a new card reader that we don't have to touch the other person's card. So I'm only handling cash.
Nice.
So we always have, I think for every 9 transactions with a card, we have 1 with cash. So I'm handling a lot less tender. So
that's good.
Yeah.
And today I actually went back to work for my main job. So I'm working from home for the next 8 weeks. Oh, so I'm getting paid for the next 8 weeks. That's good.
Yeah. Good. Good.
Nice. So yeah, working on a project that I think is gonna be super fun.
What was it, Wednesday when I was trying to talk you into coming to social distance with us.
I was
that's not how this works.
No, it is how it works. So it totally was.
Like, I was like 1 foot out the door. I was like, man, I really want to go.
Shit, dude, we didn't leave the downtown Woodstock area till 7 that night.
I pretty much had everything but my shoes on, and I was like, I really kind of just want to go. And then by the time I got off the couch and said, all right, I'm going to do it, Chelsea was pulling up, and I was like, nah, I guess.
Well, you could have brought her, but yeah.
So yeah, like, but she would have been.
Done from her freaking crazy ass job at Publix.
Yeah,
and not playing Animal Crossing.
She's got 130 something hours invested. Hold on, let me check right now.
She passed me in Zelda.
So anyways, Jake,
I'll check it right now.
He's checking that the brewery near us. They've got what, 3 tap houses, Jordan?
I think so.
But the one near my house,
165 hours in Animal
Crossing. Holy crap.
Nice.
What? I like that you have the Switch right there.
Or more. I like how it's or more.
Wait. Go to my Breath of the Wild hours.
Okay, hold on.
So anyways, so they have 3 breweries, but the one by my house is the main one, right?
Uh-huh.
135.
125. Oh. Man. Yeah, pump those numbers up. Those are rookie numbers.
But so the other two are closed down completely. The one by Jordan's house, and where's the third one, Jordan? Do you remember?
No, I don't.
Is it in Alfreda?
Wait, so the one close to me is shut down permanently?
Not permanently, just until further notice.
For now.
Yeah, the Woodstock one's the only one that's open. And they have this huge outdoor area. And they've got lawn chairs out there, you know, yard chairs, the plastic ones that look like wood, the Adriacs or whatever the fuck they are.
Yeah, you know? I know which one you're talking about.
And they got them set about 8 feet apart in front of the fire pits and 8 feet from the fire pit. And so it might be even further than that. So Vanessa, and they ask you not to move them, or they'll ask you to leave if you move them. Mm-hmm. And so Vanessa and I were sitting by those for a while. And then actually Woodstock, you can grab a beer and go walk through town. And so we found a park bench and so we could sit next to each other and ended up fucking drinking on the park bench.
That was a horrible place for that pause.
And then I got trashed and wanted pizza. And so I ordered a pizza from the pizza place down the street, which is really good pizza. And got it for pickup and stumbled my ass to their back door and picked up my pizza and then stumbled my ass back to the bench.
You don't have to get trashed to want pizza. I want pizza right now.
Well, no, I mean, that just, we were there so long. It just, oh man, it was actually really fun. So
nice.
But yeah, when I get back, Jordan, we need to go social distance at Reformation.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like within the next week or so, and I don't know why I put this deadline on myself, but like, I think once April's kind of done, I'll feel a little bit safer in May. So
no, I'm worried. I think we're going to have a spike. Florida's already seeing their spike.
Well, I think we are too. And of course, after the protests in Kentucky had their largest spike. But so this is, oh shit, hold on. Damn, we had a lot more confirmed cases from earlier today. All right, so this is what I've been doing. If you have the Weather Channel app on your phone, in the bottom right, there's a tab that you can touch that gives you all of the COVID-19 information in your county.
So it
geolocates you. It tells you how many confirmed cases there are, and it tells you how many deaths there have been specifically in your county. But under each of those numbers, it will tell you the percentage of how much it has either gone up or gone down from 7 days prior to looking at it. So for like the last 3 or 4 weeks, I've been looking at it every day, and it's always been plus 40, plus 50, or plus 40%. And when I looked at it today, it was down to only plus 19%. Huh. But now it looks like it's back up to plus 25%. But so even though the up number is still a positive number, that positive number seems to be going down. So just last week, it was 15% higher. So I'm hoping that it goes down enough to where it at least plateaus for a little bit.
Yeah.
But I have a feeling with everything opening back up today, or attempting to open back up today, that we are going to see a spike again.
Man, I'm really glad that you told me about this. It's on the weatherchannel.com too, or weather.com. And this is really easily digestible information. I love this.
Yeah. It shows your state's confirmed cases and how many deaths in your state. So we are 6 away from 1,000 deaths in the state of Georgia.
Wow.
That is 1,000 people that didn't have to die. But that's a whole nother tangent for another podcast.
Yeah, I can't. Oh. See, the place where I'm getting lucky is Utah has been real low on everything. Like, yeah. I mean, I don't want to just push aside the 41 deaths that we have had. Like Jordan just said, those 41 deaths that didn't have to die. But that was up in Salt Lake. We've had no deaths down here. And in my county, we only have 45 confirmed cases.
Well, here's the thing. The governor of California just opened everything back up because not opened everything back up. He wants a review of autopsies since December.
Yeah.
And
dude, Gavin Newsom is saving the world. Him and Cuomo.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Fauci.
And Fauci, right. But Fauci's kind of under someone's thumb. So
it's not really stopping them.
Yeah,
you guys
need to
watch that Brad Pitt video. It's actually pretty fucking funny.
Will do. But yeah, this is fantastic, Jordan. Thanks. Weather.com or Weather Channel app. This is great. Cause like I've looked at things and it's like this is like the information isn't presented as cleanly as it is right here. This is great. Mm-hmm. I love this. Yeah. So, hey guys, on that note, should we get into our lists?
Sure.
Because
I don't have one though.
Robbie, you haven't had one in the last 3 weeks. Like, why would you start now?
I don't watch documentaries.
You didn't have
one. Why not? You should. They're really good, dude.
I just haven't had watched them yet.
Says the guy who wasn't sure he's seen any documentaries. I have the group text, Josh.
Well, no, I said recent. And actually, the more I think about it, I've actually seen quite a few recently. Well, docu-series.
Well, we also decided, so the parameters we put on ourselves was that it could be a documentary or a documentary series.
Actually, wait, no.
And seeing as how we all talk...
I have a question. Does Ford versus Ferrari technically count as one of those?
Absolutely not.
Never mind.
That's a historical drama.
All right.
What were you saying, Jordan?
Historical
before
fiction. Sorry,
Josh's seed cut you off.
I don't know if we want to. I don't know if we want to. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. Do we want to exclude Tiger King since we've talked about it pretty much ad nauseum?
That's reality TV.
But no, that was a documentary. That was absolutely a documentary. I didn't have it on my list, so
I guess that can be on mine.
All right. Yeah, no, Tiger King.
That's
actually
one that I did watch.
It was. Yeah.
So it's top four, right?
Top four.
All right. I have top four and an honorable mention.
Oh, nice.
Okay.
So
I've got...
I think Jake and I might have some crossover.
That's what I'm afraid of. I know for a fact. And the one I'm thinking of, if Josh doesn't have it either, I'm kicking Robbie off the podcast.
I'm sure that the one of mine you guys have.
All right, so how about this? So how about this? If there is crossover, let's not say, oh, that's on my list. Let's just address it when we come to it. And if there's anything else we can add to what was previously said about it.
Okay, right. That's fair.
Okay. So if documentary A is my first pick, but it's Jake's third pick, he'll tell us on his third round pick and then add to what I... So does that make sense?
Yeah, so like...
Yeah, it does.
What we won't do is when me and you both had Mars Attacks at number two and I lost my shit and got super happy.
Yeah.
So we won't do that.
Okay. All right.
Got it.
That's all right. So, I'm never happy.
All right. Well, on that note, I think Josh should go first with your number four.
So, my number four, and I don't know why I do this to myself, but I really, really like watching Ancient Aliens. I get angry as fuck. I get irrationally angry watching Ancient Aliens. And it's ridiculous.
Yes.
It's absolutely ridiculous.
Absolutely.
It's like the one episode that was like God didn't exist because they were aliens.
Hold on a second. What are you doing watching Ancient Aliens?
What do you mean? What am I doing?
You were like the least...
Oh, it makes me... It fucking... If I'm in a shitty mood and I want to get in a shittier mood, I turn on Ancient Aliens. Like,
weird. I feel like
if I'm in a shitty mood and I want to be in a shittier mood.
Yeah. Yeah, if I'm angry and I want to get angrier, I just turn on Ancient Aliens. And I get...
Why would you do that to yourself?
I'm a glutton for punishment. Do you not know this?
All right, yeah. Okay, hold on, let me check my notes. All right, that's right.
So yeah, I love watching it. I think it's complete bullshit, and it's the stupidest shit I've seen. But I can't stop watching it.
That's fair. All right.
The Nazis in the occult one makes me fucking laugh hard.
Less realistic than Indiana Jones.
Oh. Oh. God, yeah. It makes... You know, that's the weirdest tangent in the whole fucking series. It really is. Nazis were trying to figure out fucking time travel? What?
Well... Those were different times.
I mean, we're all time traveling right now as we speak.
Oh gosh, no, I don't need that information.
We are. We're moving forward in time.
Yeah, at the rate of a minute every 60 seconds.
Oh.
Worst, right, I don't need your quantum physics mumbo jumbo bullshit right now.
All right, Mr. Fucking Science.
All right, Mr. Wizard. Shut the hell up.
Okay, sorry. I'll try to dumb it down for you guys. Jordan, take it away. What's your number four?
My number four is going to be... I think I might have mentioned this one on this podcast.
I swear to God, if you say Searching for Bigfoot, I'm going to lose my shit.
It's, oddly enough, it's Searching for Bigfoot. Oh, I'm sorry, did I say Bigfoot? I meant Yeti. Searching for Yeti. Searching for Yeti.
All right, that's fine. I'll take that.
That's just a snowy Bigfoot. no, it's... It's the documentary about the E.T. Atari game called Game Over. And so it was about like the myth of all of the ET cartridges, with ET the Atari game for ET being notorious for being one of the worst games ever created. And it actually single-handedly tanked the Atari system. So people like
video
just
game industry.
Yeah. Yeah. And the game itself was developed in like a ridiculous like record amount of time by one dude. And
jeez.
And then the game was not well received, but the movie had come out and was such a big hit that all these stores like ordered a large amount of these games because they thought it would just sell hand over fist. They did not. As a matter of fact, a lot of them were returned because the game was so bad. And this company didn't know what to do with them, so they just threw them away. And they all went to a landfill. I think it was somewhere in Arizona.
New Mexico.
New Mexico, there we go. I knew it was one of those states around where you are. Yeah. And so, like, the myth was that the game was so bad that they just threw all the copies in this landfill. So the documentary itself has two concurrent stories. It's the one concurrent story is the rise and fall of the popularity of the Atari 2600, but also the rise and fall of the ET game and how the failure of the ET game eventually led to the system's downfall. And during all of this, they're doing archaeological excavations for the ET games in the landfill. And it turns out that they found them. But the myth was that it was only ET games. But in actuality, it was ET games and a bunch of other not great games as well that were found in this landfill. So crazy. Once they were excavated, apparently people just, I don't know who was able to get their hands on some of them, but apparently there's a store somewhere in Orlando that's like some video game store has a copy that was pulled from the landfill and it's framed in their store.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. So that's a pretty solid documentary. It's called Game Over. And it's only like an hour and 5 minutes long.
And it's available on Amazon Prime.
Pretty sure there was a book similarly named. It was basically the
words are hard
description of all those old games.
That wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah. All right, my number four. Now, if you thought I was going to go into this list and not somehow work Rush into it, you were dead wrong. And you are a fool. Because my number four documentary is Rush, Beyond the Lighted Stage. And it's just the history of the band Rush from the very beginning all the way up until their second to last album. And it's got a who's who of musician talking heads in it. You got Trent Reznor, Kirk Hammett, Sebastian Bach, Jack Black, Gene Simmons, Billy Corgan. Oh, you know what? I'm not sure. Les Claypool, just Matt Stone.
Les Claypool, right now, Primus was going to start touring again.
Yeah,
and
I know.
They were just doing live concerts of Rush covers.
It's specifically the Farewell to Kings album.
Yes.
And so,
I almost bought tickets for it.
And yeah, I really
I'm
wanted
kinda
to.
Glad, I'm kind of glad I didn't because it's fucking canceled now. I would have been, super disappointed.
But, the fun thing about Rush is they are not a rock band. It's not a rock band story. It's not the Dirt, like Mötley Crüe. They didn't have band lifestyle. They're normal dudes. They're nerds. In this movie, they're interviewing Gene Simmons from when Rush was opening for Kiss.
Uh-huh.
And Gene Simmons is like, after the concerts, we'd be back at our hotels, just, booze and drugs and naked girls and sex. The Rush guys would be in their rooms just listening to music and writing books or reading books.
That's funny.
They're the most down to earth, but it's still just like, they have like their rock star moments, like on their fourth album, making their fourth album, 2112.
Mm-hmm.
Because before that, they made the album Caress of Steel, which is garbage. I don't care what anyone says. Rush fans apologize for, like, there's Rush fan apologists for this album. No, Caress of Steel is garbage. Even Rush hates Caress of Steel. And their producer's like, don't do anything like that again. Just make radio-friendly music. And they're like, okay. So, they made 2112, a 23-minute one song, and it just blew the gates open, their biggest hit at the time, and it just gave them the freedom, and basically it was them sticking it to the man in a very punk rock attitude for a prog rock band. Rush, Beyond the Lighted Stage.
Yeah, oh, so, another, speaking of, you know, Claypool and Rush, was it their Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction that he played at?
No, that was the Foo Fighters played at that.
Okay, so
there were two Rush tours that Primus opened for him.
Okay, anyways, yeah, Claypool did a thing where, you know, he gave a speech about, you know, how it's dangerous to meet your heroes and all this shit, and then basically said that meeting the guys from Rush was his biggest dream come true, and they became the closest friends and all that shit. And
yeah, apparently yeah. They're great guys, except yeah. for Neil. He was a little autistic and didn't really like to meet people. Wrote a whole song about it. It's called Limelight. It's one of their biggest hits.
Oh, I love that song.
So good.
Limelight's one of my favorites.
I love it. I'm unfamiliar.
It's one of the radio hits, Jordan. It's literally a song about how much, because Neil was their songwriter, it's just how much he hates being famous. Dude just likes to play the drums.
Huh, that sounds familiar.
Why?
I mean, just guy playing drums, not wanting to be famous.
Oh, yeah.
Seems like there's a punk band in San Francisco that did that same thing.
You gotta be more specific, I have no idea what you're talking about.
Operation Ivy?
Oh, right. but,
Rancid
yeah.
Rancid wrote a song about it.
Well, Rancid's half of Operation Ivy. anyway, and the common thing is, and this applies to a lot of people, except for freaking Jordan. If these guys in Rush aren't your favorite musicians, they are your favorite musicians' favorite musicians. Except for Jordan's over here, pre-Rush music. Beatles, which are also a good band, but
you're,
like,
you're all right.
I mean, Josh,
I don't even think Jordan's paying attention.
Our brother Matt,
buttons.
Okay, I got
I'm listening.
I gotta stop the Rush tirade. I've gone on far too long. Go watch it. Robbie, what's your only pick?
Wait, do we want him to go now or
what,
at number
what,
one?
What? We're gonna be surprised what his pick is.
What's your pick, Robbie?
We already mentioned it.
We had a whole episode about it.
Yeah, Tiger King. It's basically the only documentary that I really watched.
All right, back to Josh. What's your number three?
Number three, I'm going with The Toys That Made Us.
Ah, shit.
Oh,
I didn't even think about putting that one on my list.
About that.
Really? That's the one I figured that you guys would all have on your goddamn
man, list. No. I actually was, like, trying to legitimately think of like...
That was a good choice.
That was a good choice.
And that runs me... That also runs into my honorable mention. The Masters of the Universe documentary.
Shit, that was a good one too. Fuck, I didn't think about
that. So that's my number three and my honorable mention.
Nice.
I really enjoyed both of those.
Man, the By the Power of Grayskull is a really, really good documentary.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It just, because I mean, Toys That Made Us, like, touches on it.
Mm hmm.
And, you know, the whole fucking thing about the comic book, and then, oh yeah, by the way, it's a TV show that you get, you know, they touch on it in Toys That Made Us, but By the Power of Grayskull, just like, oh my god, this guy was insane. I can't believe he pulled this off.
And these are both on Netflix, right?
Yes, they are.
I should also mention Beyond the Lighted Stages on Netflix also. I want to keep... I have the website up right now where every time you guys mention one, I'll throw out where it is.
Toys That Made Us. The G.I. Joe episode's great. The Transformers episode's great. The Masters of the Universe episode's. The Barbie episode is actually.
The Barbie episode is actually my favorite.
Yeah, I learned a whole fucking lot.
So the Barbie episode is with. I sat down and I was like, man, because I was watching them in order, and I think the Barbie episode's like third or fourth. I can't remember.
Something like that.
Yeah, but I was like, man, all right, I'm just going to watch this and power through it because I don't care. And I was watching it, and I'll be damned if it's not, out of three seasons, easily the most interesting episode that they've done.
Oh yeah.
The entire series.
Like the lady that was pretty much the fucking queen of the Barbies. You know, she put so much fucking heart into that doll. And it's awesome.
But like the fact that she was modeled after a stripper in France.
Yeah, that too.
Or a prostitute in France is what it was. It was a prostitute.
Even better.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah.
And then like the guy who ended up getting control of like the entire like Barbie intellectual property was the biggest fucking, like, this dude was almost Hugh Hefner level, like, yeah. Yeah, he lived in this posh mansion and he would have like sexy parties and shit. Like, this dude, this was like Hugh Hefner light. And he's like, yeah, I own the rights to all of the Barbie or the Barbie intellectual property. So like that dude was bonkers.
I've only seen the Transformers episode. I loved it. Like, I have no reason why I didn't dive more into this show.
You should make some time to watch those because they're all.
So,
I think I need to rewatch it now.
And so there's also a spinoff on that. I haven't watched any of them yet, but The Movies That Made Us.
I've seen part of that.
Two.
Okay.
Yeah, I watched the Home Alone episode and I watched the Ghostbusters episode.
And I also have another honorable mention at the end, so.
Okay.
All right, Jordan.
This one is, I'm going to go with a music documentary called Searching for Sugar Man.
I've heard fantastic things about this, but I've never seen it, so I'm very excited that it's on your list. Tell me about it.
All right. So this is about a musician named Rodriguez from the 60s. And Rodriguez, if you haven't heard any of his stuff, it's really good. I don't want to call it folk, but it's just kind of like acoustic singer-songwriter-y stuff. But it's not, some of it's a little slow, but some of it's a little bit more upbeat. His full name is Sixto Rodriguez. So S-I-X-T-O. Anyway, so he put two albums out in the 60s. And I think that he did fairly okay. Like, I don't think he got a lot of crazy national recognition, but he did okay for himself. But I think it got to the point where it wasn't paying the bills, so he just had to do something else, and then he just fell off the face of the earth. All right, so let's fast forward to the 1980s in South Africa is going through essentially like the end of apartheid, right, which is basically their civil rights thing, like their whole separate but equal, right? Like the American South was going in the early 20th century. Same shit was going on in South Africa, but against the British citizens. And they were also fighting a lot of political activism of the time. And anyway, I don't know what it was. I can't remember how this came about, but like some guy just found this Rodriguez tape and he played it on the radio. And then Rodriguez in the 1980s became almost like the voice of the counterculture towards all of these, like the ruling class of the government. Right. But here's the thing. Nobody knew what happened to Rodriguez. So while they're all listening to him and he's getting popular in South Africa amongst this huge fan base,
Uh-huh.
Nobody knows where he is. Nobody has ever heard from him. And a whole bunch of like crazy rumors start to circulate. Like one of the rumors was that he killed himself on stage. With like he lit himself on fire on stage and just died.
Jeez.
What?
And then like there were other rumors that like he just quit and then he passed away. So it turns out that Sixto Rodriguez is still alive and he has absolutely zero fucking clue how popular his music is in South Africa.
What?
So, but again, this was the 1980s. This is before the internet. This is before, like, long distance calling was still a thing. Like, that's how long ago this was, right?
Yeah.
So he has no idea how popular he is amongst this huge counterculture in South Africa. And I guess eventually somehow word gets back to him. And he's still alive today. Like, word gets back to him that he's popular in South Africa. And it turns out that he's just been living in, like, Michigan or Wisconsin as, like, a carpenter or something of the sort. Yeah.
Whoa.
And he's like, he finds out, he's like, what? And then so people in South Africa are like, will you come and play a show? And he's like, I guess so. So they fly him out to South Africa. This is all now, like modern. So this isn't in the 80s, but his music was very instrumental in the 80s for the people who are now adults and who now have a say in like the government and whatnot. He goes out and plays these massive sold out shows in South Africa. That's and this awesome. Documentary is all about people discovering Rodriguez's music, but also Rodriguez finding out that years and years after his albums had come out, like decades after his albums had come out, it caused quite a stir amongst this counterculture in South Africa.
Whoa!
Yeah.
That's cool.
I had no idea that's what that movie was about.
Yeah, and there's an activist, I think his name is Steve Ditko. Yeah, Steve Ditko. No, not Steve Ditko. I'm thinking about somebody else. I can't remember his name, but like what, like a prominent politician for the counterculture, holds Sixto Rodriguez as like one of his many influences and in, like his foray into politics.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Which is weird because his music, like there's some social commentary in his music, but his music wasn't like overtly political.
not like Rage Against the Machine or Prophets of Rage or Public Enemy or anything like that.
Yeah.
Which I guess both of those bands are. Anyways. No, both those bands, Rage Against the Machine and Public Enemy, are Prophets of Rage plus half of Cypress Hill.
Oh, right. Searching for Sugar Man, available on Netflix.
Yeah, it's really fucking good.
It's funny because I pretty much bet that all of our fucking documentaries in this are Netflix ones.
So he quit music in 1976. All right, so his albums came out in 70 and 71, and then he quit. I'm trying to find the name of the politician that I was trying to remember earlier.
So real quick, while I was in Haiti, speaking of blues and politicians, one of the restaurants we go to.
Wait, hold on. While you talk, I'm going to dip out for just a second. Okay. Tell your story.
So one of the restaurants we used to go to was Jojo Burger. Oh, it was a really fucking great restaurant. And anyways, one of the former presidents would come into Jojo Burger and play the blues like once a week.
That's cool.
Yeah, it was pretty fucking neat. We avoided it those nights just because, he's pretty popular and drew a huge crowd. But,
yeah.
Yeah. But Jojo Burger in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, some of the best fucking food you'll ever get in your life. Just so you guys know. If you ever,
nice.
If the listeners ever find themselves in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, I feel bad for you. So,
Steve
Robbie.
Biko. Steve Biko, not Ditko, Biko. B-I-K-O.
Yeah, Steve Ditko, that's... Isn't he the fucking football coach?
No, you're thinking Mike Ditka.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Bantu Stephen Biko from South was a South African anti-apartheid activist. That's the guy I was thinking of.
Okay. All right, who's next?
Me. Speaking of documentaries you can find on Netflix, my number three was made by Netflix. So obviously it's on Netflix.
Oh, yeah.
And this was basically last year's Tiger King. My number three is Fire.
Oh, God. That was a train wreck.
What an absolute disaster that was, in the sense that I could not look away from this movie. Like, things went from bad to worse and then kept getting worse. And I'm sure most of us saw Fire, right?
Wait a minute.
I saw it.
No,
I didn't see it.
Oh, you didn't see it?
Wow. Oh, no, man. I never got to see either one of them.
It's pretty cringeworthy.
I never saw the Hulu one, which is weird considering how much I loved the Netflix one. The Hulu one was the Fire fraud, and Netflix is just Fire. Like, this con artist managed to, like... I can't tell if he thought he was actually putting together a festival and just got way in over his head, or he was conning the whole time. I don't know, but like
I feel like he was conning the whole time.
Like, he was just a guy that just lied and rolled off of his lies and just kept snowballing. Mm. And No, I know where you're going with that. No, we covered this already.
Sounds familiar. That's all.
Like, he teamed up with Ja Rule, and they were like, we're going to buy this island in the Bahamas. They got a bunch of Instagram models together.
Didn't Ja Rule get fucked in the end of all this, too?
Yep. Almost everyone did. Like, they had a full lineup of top... Like, again, I'm going to rope one of my favorite bands into my picks, but like, they even had Blink-182 lined up to play this festival. And, by the way, Blink-182's guitarist is... also the guitarist and singer of Alkaline Trio, and they have a fantastic song called Goodbye Fire Island, which is about this exact thing, because he was about to go play at it.
Wow.
So, if you haven't heard Alkaline Trio's Goodbye Fire Island, I recommend that, and if you haven't seen Fire, I recommend that. Like, seeing the pain on a man's face who is just about willing to give out blowjobs for bottled water.
Oh.
Oh, God, it
employee of the year right there.
Yeah, like this shit goes downhill. But fast.
It's a lot like Tiger King, where the dude running the show is just sleaze, and you feel for the like his crew and the people working with him. They're just normal people just trying to make a living, and you're like, these are the people getting shit on. Guys, yeah. It's wild.
Yeah. I would recommend that one.
Yes. All right, Josh, number two.
My number two is the Explained series on Netflix.
The what?
Explained.
I don't even know.
Oh, dude. So it's nice little bite-sized episodes. They're 20 minutes or less. And like the one that released today was Coronavirus Explained.
Oh.
And there's fuck, man. There's the first episode I watched was the one on female orgasm.
Oh, it does exist.
Because, well, the episode. Oh, God damn it. I did not say that. Cut that out, Jake.
No.
But I watched, yes, Robbie.
Well, I have my number one.
So
is it the female orgasm episode?
Close.
Almost there.
So anyways, yeah, Explains got a lot of good episodes in their bite size, very, very informative. And yeah, I just think it's well done, well put together, and I would recommend it to everybody.
It's fantastic. I never even heard of this. So I like these episodes. Because
bite-sized
chunks of information like that, that is my wheelhouse.
And it's a whole bunch of different topics, too. That's what's nice about it. That's
neat.
Let's see. Let me find it. So I've watched female orgasm, like I said. K-pop. Monogamy and coronavirus, and then the mind.
Corona Irish.
Coronavirus. And then
the pop K-pop singer.
The mind explained is standalone. Coronavirus is standalone. Sex explained is a standalone. I have not seen that one. But explains got. I mean. Music, water crisis, why women are paid less, political correctness, can we live forever, astrology, tattoo. I watched Tattoo. That's a pretty good one. Weed explained. I haven't watched that. Cricket explained. I need to watch Cricket explained because I don't know what the fuck this is. What's cricket?
To understand what cricket is, you need to know what a crumpet is.
I know what a crumpet is. I know goddamn well what a crumpet is. I still don't know what cricket is.
I don't know what a crumpet is.
Oh, crumpets are basically English muffins.
Ooh, I like English muffins. Don't they just call them muffins over there?
They're a little bit more eggy.
I like eggy.
Honestly. Yeah.
Not a bad thing. So, all right, I'm going to check this one out. I'm going to check all these out. Available on Netflix.
I now have two, by the way, for my second and first. I just remembered.
Wait, Josh, we're on number two, right?
Yes, we're on number two.
All right, I think we should go to Robbie for his number two now.
How It's Made.
How is that not your number one?
Hold on, no.
You just sent me two of them, and I told you, yes, they're both documentaries. And you did the best one last?
I think the other one, I just said, is a bit better than the one I just said.
How It's Made is one of the best, worst series ever.
It's totally Canadian. It's great.
Like, I don't care how garage doors are made, but 5 minutes in, you damn well better know I care about how garage doors are made.
Oh, Jesus. Like, did you see the Bentley episode?
No.
Oh my god. Like, you know, we know cars are made in factories that make fucking cars. Bentleys, oh no, they're handmade.
Yeah.
Jeez. Like there's Rars a guy with a fucking English wheel making fucking fenders.
Like, I feel like How It's Made is just visual ASMR.
Probably.
I don't know what ASMR is.
I forgot what it stands for.
Yeah, I have no idea what it stands for. I just know what it is.
Well, fuck you guys. I'm getting my Urban Dictionary out.
It's autonomous sensory meridian response.
Oh, okay.
So there you go. Anyway, sorry, Robbie. I just bulldozed your whole thing. Tell me about How It's Made. Tell me how it's made.
Well, all the episodes are intricate. They each have
You're damn right.
three things in it. Each it tells about those certain things, how it's put together, and it's just really visually appealing.
I was really hoping you would say it tells how it's made.
Hold on, I have a serious question. Is every episode really about three things?
I think,
I've seen some with more, some with less.
Okay, yeah, so they purposely segment the episode so that it has multiple things in this one episode. And it's just really cool how they do that.
You almost said how it's made. It's really cool how it's made. I heard it. All right. Wait, is that... But,
yeah, that's one that I remembered. And the other one, I'll tell you in a minute.
Yeah, hold on. How it's made is streaming on Hulu. 3 seasons of it.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Man, I need to turn on my Hulu more often.
All right, Jordan, you're number two.
My number two, Jake, I have a feeling we're both going to have the same number one. My number two is actually going to be a Disney documentary called Walt and El Grupo.
I've never seen that.
Oh, shit. This is an awesome doc. I actually used this documentary a lot whenever I was writing my senior thesis in college. Uh-huh. So the documentary is about Walt Disney and his goodwill mission or his goodwill trip to South America right before America entered World War II. So there's a lot of shit going down at Disney Studios in the beginning of the 40s. Like, his entire animation studio goes on strike. And this depresses him really bad because he, you know, Walt's like, oh, I thought we were all a family. Turns out he was actually underpaying a lot of people and overworking a lot of people, if I'm being honest.
That's fair to
say. Yeah, no, I mean, that's exactly what was happening. Like, there's also still a lot of discrimination going on, sexual discrimination. Like, a lot of, we all know the stories about the ink and paint department being pretty much just women. Mm-hmm. And anyway, so America hadn't entered the war just yet. But I think they knew it was coming. So, the president asked Walt Disney, hey, would you go down and as a goodwill trip, go down to South America and kind of like sweet talk them? And Walt was like, I'm not really a politician. I don't really feel comfortable doing that. To which the president said, how about we give you a bunch of money to make movies about the stuff you find out down there? And Walt's like, well, I like to make movies. Sure, I'll do that. So he essentially gets this large sum of money to take a team of artists, which include Mary Blair, probably the most notable of the bunch. But they go on this, essentially like this tour of South America, and they're learning the culture. You know, I should say they're doing their best to learn the culture. And a lot of it gets reflected in a lot of these animation shorts and these animated movies that come out from this. So like stuff like Three Caballeros and Saludos Amigos come out of this goodwill mission. A lot of instructional videos come out of this. However, a lot of those instructional videos are very controversial because they are a very white Western minded mindset that basically underplays the culture of South Americans and like the various cultures of South Americans, right? Because not everybody in South America has the same culture. It's right. Like, you know, people of one area are different from other people of another area and so on and so forth, with different customs and cultures and whatnot. But so a lot of them, but at the time people were like, oh yeah, that's absolutely right. But they're, you know, the people in these South American countries aren't depicted as accurately as they should have been. But in America, people are like, oh yeah, that's totally how people live down there. When it wasn't true. But because of Walt's goodwill mission, apparently around the same time the Nazis had sent some people to South America too.
Oh, geez.
Because that was also the thing, was like, well, if the Nazis send people over, then they're on this side of the world, right? The Nazis are that much closer to America, and we don't want them to be close to America.
Right.
So, then the stories of how Walt Disney was received in certain areas down there. There was like one that was like a huge dinner party that was held for Walt. And the title that everybody said was, which is the name of the documentary, was that it was Walt and El Grupo, which was Walt's group, the group.
I thought it was a person.
I thought it was a person too.
like El Chapo.
Yeah, it's literally my exact same thought process. This movie came out in 2008. Up until just this moment, so for the last 12 years, I thought El Grupo was a guy.
I take it back. It wasn't the president. It was Rockefeller. It was Rockefeller who was the what was he at the time?
The railroad tycoon.
The treasurer, yeah, but he had a prominent position.
Wait, he was a government official as well.
I'm trying to remember.
That Rockefeller was dead. It had to be a child.
It was a Rockefeller.
The third.
I can't fucking remember.
So speaking of Disney and communism and Nazism and all that shit. This is a little tangent while you guys are looking that up. I watched Hail Caesar last night.
Oh, nice. How was that?
I love Coen Brothers movies. I really fucking do.
I love movies about Hollywood.
Anyway, they got Clooney's character to join their communist club, right? And so when they're entering his name in the book, like a couple lines up, the name above him was Mark Davis.
Wow, really?
Yeah, it made me fucking laugh. Cool. It made me laugh really fucking hard.
I think it might have been JD Jr.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm trying to confirm now.
Because by World War II, you know.
Yeah. Because JD died in 37.
Yeah,
he died in 37. Yeah, so it would have been JD Jr. Anyway, so the entire documentary is about not necessarily the animation stuff that they came up with, but like the political ramifications of a friendly figure like Walt Disney making friends with foreign political leaders of South America at the time. Mm-hmm. The result from that, a couple of things happened when he came back. America was pretty much entering the war at that point, and he mm-hmm. offered his studio to be used as an army base. So a lot of troops were stationed at the studio, and he suspended all work on active animation features, and he started to produce like the instructional videos for the army, like those instructional videos of like how to put tanks together
and propaganda.
Yeah, so like that's where we get Victory Through Air Power. So he had like all these propaganda films, but what a lot of people don't realize is that the stuff that he ended up making because of the trip, so stuff like Three Caballeros, Saludos Amigos, all those Disney shorts, all the like the Donald Duck versus Hitler shorts, like all of those ended up being propaganda pieces anyway, because all of the funding that was given to him by the government was used to fund all of those. So those are all technically propaganda pieces.
That's interesting.
Weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I actually knew that those were all propaganda from that trip.
But there's also a really good book.
Hey, is that documentary on Disney Plus?
No, it's always...
it is.
What? It is?
I think it is.
Not according to this website, but let me double check. Yeah, according to this, it's only on the Stars.
It was, because I sold my copy because it was on Disney Plus.
Oh.
I hope I hope not. Now I'm like, I'm gonna be mad.
So Jake, you're number two.
All right. Anyway, my number two. This is the only documentary that I've ever seen. Is it on there?
Yeah, it's on there.
Okay. All right. And this website that I put 100% of my trust in has let me down.
Hey, send us a link so I can get it.
Wait, it says it's a clip, but it's only a clip, but it says it's also an hour and 47.
Oh yeah, that's a full length. My number two, again, it's the only documentary I've ever seen in theaters, and it was just a couple years ago. It's a fairly recent one. I openly wept watching this film. This film is a treasure, and if you have not seen Won't You Be My Neighbor? What are you doing with your life?
I haven't seen it.
Oh, no. Man. So
is it documentary? Oh, okay. So what's the Tom Hanks one?
That is It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not that one. This is the documentary about Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers.
Okay.
It is so well put together, and you get a glimpse into this man's life. Surely he couldn't be this wholesome dude that we all knew and grew up with. Maybe there's some dark cracks in his life or something. No. This man was probably one of the greatest people ever to live. Yeah. The things that he did that would have been considered controversial at the time, but...
like having a black man on his fucking show?
Beyond that, not just having black men on a show.
That's horrible that was controversial.
But that's what I'm saying. He went beyond that. So there's episodes where him and the black guy, what's the character's name?
He was the mailman.
Yeah, the mailman. Anyway, they would go into Mr. Rogers' backyard and soak their feet in a pool together.
Yeah.
And just have open conversation. This was radical at the time, and this was a kid's show. And,
jeez.
Fred Rogers, he was a Republican, he was a Christian pastor.
But that's when conservative met conserve, though.
Right. But he was fine with it. There was one of the cast members on his show was an openly gay man. Fred Rogers was fine with it. And this is in the 70s.
Wow.
But seriously, that's it was the late 70s when that shit changed. It changed with Nixon.
You know? I don't know anything about that, but But the things that he did episodes on, he did it again, remember this is all a kid's show. One of his very early episodes was after a great tragedy, but I can't remember what it was right now. I don't remember if it was it might have been the Kennedy assassination, but I'm not sure. That seems a little early for that. Or maybe one of the space disasters. I don't remember.
Anyways.
One of his early episodes just covered a great tragedy, but made it understandable for kids. And this guy, he put it out there in a way where...
Here I was as a fucking third grader watching the Challenger explode live on TV in school.
Right, but he made it in a way that he encouraged kids to be open with their feelings and open with themselves, and I feel like a lot of us that got lost over the years, and just I don't know where that went, but there's a large group of people who are not open with their feelings and fight it and be the person that Mr. Rogers wants you to be, guys. Seriously,
yeah, no. Fred was fucking amazing, and I want to see that documentary.
Yeah, the documentary, the Tom Hanks movie was really good, but it just didn't touch on things. It was a drama told over a couple days. But the documentary, Won't You Be My Neighbor, just spans so much time and just all the fantastic things he did. And one of my favorite parts is the camera crew, the behind the scenes crew on his show. Mm-hmm. Just a ragtag team of just it'd be like if we were the camera crew.
Oh no.
Just drunk, swearing, having fun, partiers. Mr. Rogers loves them all.
Why are you talking shit about me? I'm right here.
I'm just, hey, you know what? If Mr. Rogers accepted them, he would accept you also.
Aw, that's sweet.
Like, he might be one of the greatest people to ever live. Just the things he did, the policies he made. I'm kind of tearing up right now thinking about it.
No, and so, you know, there's a lot of people in the world that, like, we look up to. But when you fucking dig down into it, they're assholes.
Mm-hmm.
And Fred Rogers is not one. Bob Ross is not one.
And, like...
Was not. I should...
But, like, even... But he did have his own personal issues, but he worked with... Like, this is the entire concept of Daniel Tiger, the puppet. Like, there were things that Mr. Rogers couldn't talk about because it was hard for him. But when he put it into a character of Daniel Tiger, they came out. Like, Daniel Tiger is him. But, like, the deep him. And, yeah, it is wild. And you're just like, holy shit. Like, he was a flawed person, but he worked with it. Right. And he teaches us that work with your flaws. Be you.
No, like, I really got to say that, you know, growing up, I fucking appreciated him, like, so much. And Robbie missed out on all that.
Yeah.
And it sucks.
I was even a little too young for it. Like, I barely remember it.
Dude, have you ever seen his deposition to Congress?
Yeah, that's covered in the documentary. Glorious.
Oh, God.
Glorious.
Like, make a grown-ass man cry.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so, anyways.
Where is that documentary on?
It is streaming on the HBO apps.
Damn.
But, of course, you can buy it and rent it anywhere. But
right. Well, I'm probably going to have to watch that.
No, so, I'm going to as well. I'll tell you what, Robbie. Next pay, I'll rent it. And I'll watch it, and I'll let you know when I'm done with it so you can watch it.
All right.
Yeah, I feel like, especially now, we all need a little bit of Mr. Rogers in our life.
That's a goddamn understatement.
And if it wasn't for my number one, this would be my number one.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going on to number one?
Before we get into number one, so here's what we're going to go. Josh, then Robbie, and then Jordan. But since we're down to number one, like, if we have the same one, Jordan, I can just jump on, right?
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, we'll tag team it then.
All right.
Because this has turned into a 2-hour-long episode.
That's fine. How often do we do this?
Not very often, and I love it. I fucking love it.
Yeah, no, I get to hang out with you guys. It's fantastic. Anyway, Josh, so, your number one.
My number one is how beer saved the world.
I'm not it heard about is, this.
It is fucking amazing. Like oh my god.
It's a Discovery Channel show.
Save the world or change the world? Save the world.
Save the world.
Okay, so I wasn't wrong. Like it goes in and there's a debate on whether beer was found first or bread was discovered first. Like because they're the same fucking thing. They are literally the same fucking thing.
Someone just left it out and got one or the other.
Right. And so that's a huge debate. And then that's where the show starts. And it goes into how the Jews building the pyramids, the slave Jews building the pyramids were actually paid.
That's actually refuted, by the way.
Is it really?
Yeah, there's a lot more evidence to suggest that there were legitimate workforces for the pharaohs building the pyramids.
Well, that's what this show says, is that they were paid, but they were paid in beer. And
which, that kind of makes sense going throughout history, because, I mean, there was no monetary value on a lot of things. Like, at one point, salt was money.
Right. It's the whole, what's the word? The trading of goods for goods.
Yeah, right. Commerce?
I'm having a brain fart. Huh?
I said commerce, but that's not the right word.
No, no, but there's an actual word for it. I'll think of it like 2 a.m. and I'll text you. but, you know, it's just like, and then the, shit, it goes into the potato famine. It goes into bad water while we're exploring America. It goes into a whole lot of shit. It goes into fucking sailors, you know, crossing the seas and getting scurvy. The cure for fucking scurvy was grog. Grog was literally ale, rum, and lemons. And we know now that was lemons that cured scurvy.
Because of the vitamin C.
Yeah, but at the time, they didn't know that. They just know that this concoction fucking worked.
Yeah.
That's actually where the term limey comes from.
Really?
Yeah, people sucking on limes. Limey.
What about blimey?
I have no idea. I'm not going to look that up.
Okay, so can I throw my honorable mentions in real quick since I'm done with number one?
I just want to say How Beer Saved the World is not streaming anywhere, but you can buy it on Amazon.
It's great, and I would really recommend anybody to... Can you rent it on Amazon?
Nope, it just says buy.
It's worth it.
Let me double check Amazon.
I've watched it probably 3 or 4 times. It's a great show. So my honorable mentions is on Netflix. There is the history of hip hop.
That's a good one too. Hip Hop Evolution.
Yeah, Hip Hop Evolution. It's great.
That's a good one.
Holy it is shit, really good it's one. Great. And then, that was it. That was my other honorable mention. I mentioned the other honorable mention earlier. All right.
Well, let me knock out, because I have a couple of honorable mentions. The Beatles Anthology, which is like an 8-part documentary, and that's how I essentially like found out about the Beatles and became a Beatles fan.
That was your starting point?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. My starting point was the Beatles.
No, it wasn't. They were broken up for 7 years. When you were born.
No, I ran into the fucking drummer one day at.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't. No, I hate this story. This is the worst story.
The second
that thought he was a drummer for the Beatles.
All right, that's actually kind of a good story.
Yeah, but you tell it like that.
Second honorable mention is a documentary on Netflix called The 13th, and it's all about the 13th Amendment and how it's essentially legalized enslavement. So the 13th Amendment was passed after the Civil War ended, and it freed the enslaved people in the American South. But the wording in the amendment basically says if you've committed a crime, then you lose all those rights, and then you can essentially become enslaved again the penal code and imprisonment. So yep. there's a lot of and there's like the wording is also very vague of like what you could be imprisoned for. So that's why like during the late 1800s, like during the tail end of Reconstruction, all of these Jim Crow laws started to pop up so they could specifically target African Americans, and that would all hold underneath the 13th Amendment. It's really shitty. Like, it's a good documentary because it's a good documentary, but like the laws are all like, it just shows you how skewed the laws are and how racially biased the laws are. Yeah. So that's a very good documentary. And, all right, Jake, I think I'm just going to dive in. You ready?
All right. Number one, take it.
Number one, King of Kong.
Number one, King of Kong.
King of Kong.
That was my other honorable mention.
That's my number one. And Jordan's number one.
Yeah.
I mean, I had to go with beer. I'm sorry. I had to go with beer.
Oh, no shit.
King of Kong was insane. Like, when I watched it, Jake told me to watch it. I was in Fort Pierce, Florida. Fucking, what was it? Like 50 miles from West Palm?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was literally sober. I was sober and I was gonna fucking drive to that asshole's restaurant and punch him in his fucking face.
So, Jordan, why don't you go take it away for the viewers what King of Kong is, in case you haven't heard of this master. Can I just say that not only is this my favorite documentary, this is one of my favorite movies of all time. Of all movies. Go ahead.
So I mean, obviously, like any other documentary, like all of the information is framed how the documentarian wants you to see it, right? So there's two guys who are battling it out for the high score, the Guinness World Record high score for Donkey Kong. A guy named Billy Mitchell, a guy named Steve Wiebe. And the documentary makes Billy Mitchell look like the absolute worst human being on the fucking planet. And they also kind of make him out to look like a giant douchebag. Like he's got a mullet and he fucking walks around in these like weird American flag suits. And he has like a line of barbecue sauces and hot sauces. And then there's like this ho-hum everyday guy, Steve Wiebe, who was like a former school teacher.
Yeah.
And they're battling it out over who has the high score. And then there's a lot of like some fuck shit that went down.
Some fucking shit.
Yeah. There that was. Went down
regarding the legitimacy of somebody's videotape of themselves getting the high score. And there's a lot of controversy back and forth between these two guys. And in the documentary, it seems like Steve Wiebe wants to like be friendly with Billy Mitchell, but Billy Mitchell doesn't want to be friendly with Steve Wiebe. And again, like the documentary makes Billy Mitchell turn out or look to be kind of like an asshole. Funny side story is I bumped into Billy Mitchell at Dragon Con years ago, but I didn't realize it was him when I bumped into him. And when I turned around to go and say hello to him, he was already halfway down the hallway, but he had his little referee buddy with him.
Walter?
Yeah, the dude who runs the arcade, or who ran. I think he passed away recently.
Walter Day did? Oh, man.
I think so. I don't know. Double fact check me on that.
All right, I'm looking it up.
But he had his little referee arcade owner buddy with him. And by the time I got back around the corner, he was already like about halfway down the hallway and I didn't want to run after him. But my buddy Sean, who has gone to a number of video game conventions in Orlando, swears up and down that Billy Mitchell is one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, like, I assumed he liked his fans. Like, I feel like something accurately portrayed in this movie is that he likes the attention. But, yeah. But part of one of the great things about this movie is the very colorful cast of side characters, like aforementioned God. Walter Day. So, the arcade owner in Wreck-It Ralph is actually based on Walter.
Yes. So
Steve Litvak. That's cool. Mr. Litvak. That's
interesting.
But, like, there's the old lady that was going for the Q-Bert record. Oh, Walter Day's still alive. He's just retired. Okay. That's what it okay. was. And then one of my favorites, this is watching a man break on camera when, so there's this guy named Brian Koo, who his life goal was to get the first public Donkey Kong kill screen. Because it hadn't ever been recorded in public yet. Kill screen is, back in the day, video games didn't end, but at some point,
the game had to stop.
The data just, it was too much for it, and it basically crumbled. Like, it just went all haywire. So the kill screen on Donkey Kong was, you'd be going, and Mario or Jumpman would just die instantly, and that was the end of the game. It had been done in private, so Steve Wiebe shows up to one of these competitions where Billy Mitchell and his cronies, like Brian Koo, were all, or I guess Billy Mitchell was not there at this one, but Steve's just kicking ass at Donkey Kong, sits down, and he's just going, he's in the zone, he's going. this Brian Koo character notices and starts to like put some pressure on him. So he's going around the arcade telling everybody, hey, there's a possible Donkey Kong kill screen coming up, you know. And he says something along the lines of like he wanted to get into Steve's head. Those weren't his words exactly, and it was more implied than anything. But so Steve just has this big crowd of people behind him, and he gets it. He gets the first public kill screen, and it's on tape. The documentary crew gets it, and the interview of the Brian Koo character afterwards, literally just a broken dude. Just someone just walked into his arcade on allegedly one of the hardest Donkey Kong machines. They say it's cursed, and he gets the first kill screen.
Well, and it's also like not to cut you off, but like there's regulations on what Donkey Kong machine you can use too,
right?
Because like they have to be built a certain way or with certain components for the score to be valid. Like you can't just get the high score on the Donkey Kong Nintendo cartridge. It has to be this cabinet, which was produced from between year A to year B.
Which is a plot point in the movie when they think that Steve Wiebe's motherboard had been tampered with,
right,
or something. And like breaking into someone's garage and just really shitty, seedy activities going on in this movie.
Yeah, it's absolutely fucking insane. But like I said, I almost drove to West Palm Beach that night just to fucking punch that guy.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, there was news, I can't remember if it was last year or the year before, but Billy Mitchell was outed as a cheater and all of his video game records have been erased.
Oh,
wow.
Good. And he has been banned from ever competing.
Yep. Oh, I didn't read that.
That makes me so happy.
Yeah, he is. Billy Mitchell holds zero video game records.
Wow.
And I don't even know who has. Steve Wiebe isn't top on Donkey Kong anymore, but he is immortalized in this movie. And this movie is just a roller coaster.
So he's the one in Seattle, right?
Yeah.
So I just really feel like he's the kind of person that wouldn't give a shit if he's not the top scorer. He just likes the competition.
And he even says, like, at one point, he says, like, he did his best, and that's all he could do, and he was fine with it.
Right, yeah. Right. Like, the dude is like a genuine, just down to earth, friggin' awesome guy.
Yeah. And yeah, this, like, when I first heard about this movie, I had no idea that the competitive retro video game world would have any interest in me on me at all. And I think it's kind of like Tiger King, where the documentarian started making this film and they just kind of fell into this world of wild, wacky shit. There's like, whoa. And I think, they got lucky on this one and they made a hell of a movie. And again, I agree with Jordan. I think a lot of it is they framed it in the way they wanted to, and Billy Mitchell is a hell of a villain. He's one of the best movie villains of all time.
Right?
So, we didn't do Robbie's number one.
Yeah.
Oh. I guess I'm just used to Robbie not having one.
Yeah.
Anyway, King of Kong, hold on. It's only streaming on the Stars app, but worth a purchase. Go buy it. Great. Definitely. One of the greatest movies of all time. Anyway, Robbie, what's your number one? We'll wrap this up.
The World According to Jeff Goldblum.
I was waiting for someone to say this one. Nice!
Yeah, I just realized that's one of the documentaries that I've watched. I'm like, oh shit. I should have put that on my list, but yeah.
I really like that movie. Speaking of colorful characters, Jeff Goldblum is so damn weird in the most delightful way. And I'm going to be honest, I only watched the first three episodes of it with full intention of finishing the series because I loved it. I don't know why.
I finished the whole thing. It was really interesting, just everything in it.
Yeah, obviously this is on Disney Plus.
I got to say, I don't think he's weird. He's eccentric.
I feel like that's a weirdness, but an acceptable one.
It is, but it's a positive weirdness.
Like, someone could be eccentric like that and wildly creepy, but he pulls it off.
Excuse me. So,
yeah, I do thoroughly enjoy that show on Disney Plus, and renewed for a second season, which has me also excited.
Wait, this could be a second season? Awesome.
So yeah. a friend of mine and Vanessa's was in the trailer for that.
Right.
And it was the ice cream episode, but she's not in the fucking ice cream episode.
That sucks.
So hey, it just makes me laugh because this friend, she's a her Instagram handle is Doris Mayday, and it's funny because it was her roller derby name. But she's a rockabilly girl, and yeah, she was in the trailer, and then she was devastated that she wasn't in the episode.
That sucks.
She's in the trailer.
Yeah, and she's also in she's in the oh god, My Weird Phobia or whatever the fuck it is. You guys remember that one?
My Weird Addiction?
Yeah.
I refuse to watch My Weird Addiction.
Oh, so she's in an episode of that, but my favorite episode of that was the El Camino guy.
Oh, okay, good.
The guy that had to wash his hands every time he saw an El Camino because El Caminos are just dirty.
I guarantee that guy's still alive.
Yeah, I mean, I don't blame him. Like, I agree. El Caminos are fucking dirty.
So, real quick follow-up to my Walt and El Grupo. Since I couldn't find it on, like, I had a copy and I sold it because I looked it up and it was on Disney Plus, but it's not on Disney Plus anymore. So I went to Amazon and apparently now it is out of print. And if you want to buy a copy brand new from Amazon, it's $40.
How much did you sell yours for?
Like $4 or $5.
Oh.
And but the cheapest used is $12. So I went to eBay and I found a brand new copy from some like mom and pop DVD store online for $12, so I just bought it.
Nice. I'm curious to see if it's on YouTube. Just now you can buy it on YouTube. But
yeah, that's a purchase. Like I'm kind of kicking myself and getting rid of my previous copy, but I have a copy again, so.
But worth purchasing?
Yeah, definitely worth purchasing.
All right,
worth my reinvestment of $12 in that movie.
Well, listener, I hope you've enjoyed this episode that will last you at least four commutes. This is a four commute episode. These are numbers I've just made up. So, anyway, thanks for listening. And on that note, here's this note.
Yeah, oh yeah, what condition my condition was in. I woke up this morning with the sun down shining in. I found my mind in a brown paper bag, but then I tripped on a cloud and fell 8 miles high. I tore my mind on a jagged sky. I just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
Yeah, yeah, oh yeah, what condition my condition was in.